दिव्या स्टार्ट பண்ணலாம் दिव्या यू कैन स्टार्ट
St. Joseph's College of Engineering. You choose, we do it. Department of Information Technology.
Department of Information Technology, with state-of-art research facilities and well-qualified faculty members, produces young aspiring engineers ever since its inception in 1997, which has
prominent and leading employers have made the placement record of the department excel. IT department has signed MOU with various leading industries for technical collaboration. The department has been awarded a Center of Excellence with EMC and Salesforce and became an academic partner for promoting talent of higher caliber with VMware IT and Wipro Technologies.
We have collaborated with several reputed training partners, which include SkillRack, AMCAD, Sixbrace, Aspiring Minds, CoCubes, etc.
There are 25 well-qualified and dedicated faculties, with 14 of them holding doctoral degree from various reputed universities and 9 pursuing their doctoral. It is indeed an honor to know that 4 of our faculty members have received the authorization of supervision to PhD scholars. Our faculty members, besides teaching, are involved in many activities like continuing education, technical consultancy, research and development, coordinating professional bodies such as IEEE, CSI chapter, etc.
The Department of Information Technology is equipped with spacious laboratories with high-end computing systems suitable for research and development activities. Our department is well equipped with programming algorithms, compiler education lab, and interactive computing lab, app and software development lab, incremental development, R&D lab, Big Data and Skill Development Lab.
Audio Jungle. Audio Jungle.
Audio Jungle. Audio Jungle. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. Divya here. Welcome you all to the day three of our FDP on applications of image processing organized by IT Department, St. Joseph's College of Engineering, Chennai, and associated with NCCR, National Center for Coastal Research, Ministry of Earth Sciences, Government of India, NEOT Campus, Chennai. May I request Helton ma'am to welcome address, deliver the welcome address. Over to you, ma'am.
Yes, thank you, Divya. Very good morning to everyone. I extend my warm welcome to you all on behalf of IT Department, St. Joseph's College of Engineering, Chennai. I thank our Honorable Chairman, Dr. Babu Manoharan sir, our Managing Director, Jessie ma'am, our Director, Sashi sir, our Principal, Vadi Seshagiri Rao sir, our Dean, Dr. Parvathavathini ma'am, and our beloved HOD, Lata Salvi ma'am, for being a constant support to conduct this event. Today, we have two eminent resource persons, Dr. Sundara Balan, Director, Geosensing and Imaging Consultancy, Trivandrum, and Dr. P. Suresh Kumar with us to speak about industrial image processing. I take this opportunity to welcome them on behalf of IT Department, St. Joseph's College of Engineering. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, Suresh sir will be presenting a small recap of our past 2 days of FDP. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Divya ma'am. We heartily welcome you all to this day three session. We have a proverb, like, if we are failing to recollect our previous learning, then we are planning to forget the same. So it is always better to have a quick recap of processing and underwater image processing. The past 2 days sessions were handled by Dr. Sisir Kumar Dash, Scientist Deportion, NC Chennai. Coastal applications that discuss topics as follows. So topic number one is geomatics, and then coastal processes, accession and erosion, coastal zone and the climate change, shoreline management, coastal hazards like tsunami, oil spill and flood, coastal flood warming system, ecosystem modeling. During day two, Dr. Sisir came up with a wonderful presentation to explain us satellite image processing for ocean application. And he explained about the topics, remote sensing, geostationary satellites and air observation satellites, capabilities of passive sensors, eddies and ocean currents, satellite images, at last fish finding. He has also enlisted some glimpse on altimetry application research areas like operational oceanography, geodesy and geophysics. The participants' responses expresses that the initial two sessions have enlightened them with remote sensing applications. We are sure that all the upcoming three sessions will be very informative too. So stay connected. Thank you.
Thank you for the highlights, sir. It's really helpful to recollect the previous sessions. Thank you, sir. May I request Kalevani ma'am to introduce our resource persons. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Divya. I am very excited to introduce Dr. Sundara Balan and Dr. Suresh Kumar. Dr. Sundara Balan, he pursued his BE and ME in Electronics and Communication Engineering and an university. He worked as a software engineer in Aeronautical Development Agency, Bangalore, from June 2007 to July 2009. He completed his PhD in the area of Ocean Satellite Remote Sensing, IIT Madras, in the year 2015. During the same year, he received pre-doctoral fellowship award in IIT Madras in the year 2015. He was an ad hoc faculty in the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering in NIT Calicut from August 2015 to December 2015. He functioned as a postdoctoral researcher in the laboratory of Oceanology and Geoscience in the University of Littoral Opal Coast, France, from Jan 2016 to Jan 2017. He has been a research scientist at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, Maryland, USA, in the year 2019. Currently, he is the director of Geosensing and Imaging Consultancy, Trandra. His research area includes satellite remote sensing, satellite image processing, noise corrections, calibration or validation of satellite sensors, algorithm development, radiative transfer model, marine optics, shipborne field measurements, bio-optical modeling, sediment transport, and coral reef monitoring. He has published several papers in highly reputed journals. About Suresh Kumar, he received his MS in system software from BITS Pilani. Presently, he is working as a scientist G in Avinotis Weapon System Directorate, Aeronautical Development Agency. His field of interest are combat flight simulation, pilot vehicle interface design, and Avinotis system design. Then over to Divya.
Thank you, ma'am. We are very happy to welcome you both to IFDP, sir. Very happy. Before moving on to the session, may I call Tamil Selvi ma'am to read out the guidelines for the participants?
Thank you, Divya ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, everyone. Let me read out the guidelines for the participant. Active participation is expected throughout the session, all the 5 days. On day 5, an online quiz will be conducted. Feedback or attendance link will be shared anytime during or at the end of the session with the prior information and enough time. So always stay connected to the session. E-certificate and PPT will be provided only for the active participant identified based on attendance, feedback submission, and performance on online quiz on day 5. Your registration and inconsistent participation will not be entertained. All the session will be delivered through YouTube channel. You can use either desktop or laptop or mobile phone with better connectivity. Earphone will be an added advantage. Person who post inappropriate comments or discussion will be blocked and immediately terminated from the event. You can post your queries in the chat box during the session. It will be answered at the end of the session. Looking forward for your regular participation and support for the smooth conduct of this event. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the instructions. We really appreciate your understanding and support, participants. Be connected. Yes, I wish you all a very good day. Now may I request Indra Balan sir to take up the session. Please, sir.
Institute and principal, vice principal, dean, and all the faculties of different departments, all the head of the department, head of departments of different departments, and also all the faculty from various departments. Also, my thanks to. So, and finally, I'm also sure the special thanks to the organizing committee for doing the excellent job for the last 3 days and another 2 days that to come. Good morning to all the participants who were enjoying the last 3 days and were waiting for other presentation also. So, thanks, and I'll share the PPT now. So, hope I'm enjoying the presentation also. So, thanks. So we'll talk about applications of image, like satellite image processing for ocean and like an optical ocean, oceanography, optical, how we can explore the aquatic system from the optical, through optical remote sensing or optical sensors like that. So myself, I'm Sundar Balan, currently working as a director, doing a director position, holding the director position in the geosensing and imaging consultancy. So let me introduce myself. I worked as like past 10 years I was in this field I started this field from Aeronautical Development Agency, then IIT Madras, then France from Laboratory of Oceanology and Geoscience, and then NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. So I got some knowledge, a little knowledge from these different institutes, and so hope I have to learn a lot of things from again by doing different research domain. So first of all, why we want to do the aquatic remote sensing. So this is like Gaston, which you can see from US. This is one of the inland water which we can see from US. We can see this how this water is dominated with the sediments, right? So, and another one is like green. So this is like Lake Erie. So you can see here in the top here, this is the Lake Erie. So in the global ocean itself, you can see on the inland water area. So how much big is that lake? So you can guess like that. So this is two reasons we want, because of these two reasons we want this application of satellite image processing for aquatic systems maintaining. So there are a lot of process going on with this aquatic satellite image processing. So I will take you all to this session for this inland waters aquatic remote sensing. So why we need to study about the ocean? Like 70% of the ocean is covered by the earth is covered by the ocean, and it maintains the climate and oxygen balance. There are a lot of systems are unexplored. A lot of resources are unexplored in the ocean, and still we need to explore more. So if you are going by instrument and to the ocean, it will be very difficult, and the cost wise also it's very high amount you have to pay. So the remote sensing is one of the major tool. We can explore a lot of things from the ocean and inland waters, and maintain the coastal zone managements like that. So what are the major portions involved in this? Is like optical oceanography, which includes biogeo optics, ocean color remote sensing, radio to transfer theory, underwater visibility and communication, instrument design, sensor design. So along to this, I didn't added some 2-3 points like machine learning, deep learning, artificial intelligence. All these things are coming into the picture. So before going to this, I worked with the different organizations like European Space Agency towards the improvement of atmospheric correction. So why we need to atmospheric correction? There are like clouds, haze conditions will be there to capture them when we are capturing the image from the satellite. So we have to remove those images, that noise. So I worked in that as a USGS, and USGS is for water quality monitoring. So we just saw the images. So how we want to monitor that changes in the water column. So like that, those things. And another IOCCG, International Ocean Color Coordinating Group. So for atmospheric correction algorithms. And GOSI is from Korea, and I worked for the inversion models. And DRDO, underwater visibility in open and coastal waters. So this is like we will see a little bit in the underwater visibility in this presentation. So which will be helpful for you for the fifth day presentation, like underwater image processing. And then ISRO, we developed an algorithm for detection of the harmful algal blooms. So second. Okay. So how the light is penetrating below the water, and how it interacts with the ivory column. So when we are going to see the water column, so there will be a lot of parameters involved, the constituents, concentration of the sediments and chlorophyll. Chlorophyll means like blooms. Those things will be dominated in these images. So for the coastal waters or inland waters. So when the sunlight enters into the sea, so it interacts with the atmosphere, and finally it reaches the earth surface, like ocean surface or aquatic surface, and then it will reach just by the Snell's law, we can estimate the transmission, and then it interacts with each column. Each column have different properties of the water, like concentration will change with different options, like different based on the environment it will change. So at each depth we have different concentration, and finally it interacts with the bottom, and then it goes up with after interacting with the different parameters, and then we will collect the satellite will collect the signal as LWO. It's like water living radiance. So we can calculate the reflectance by using the ratio of LWO by ED. So output by input, right? Like that. So you are giving ED as the input, and output is like LWO. So based on that, we can calculate the reflectance. So there are two types of optical properties. So inherent optical properties and apparent optical properties. So inherent optical properties means the properties which depends only on the based on the medium, water column. So like, so absorption, scattering and attenuations are the like inherent optical properties. And apparent optical properties is like radiance, irradiance and the reflectance. So which is like inherent optic, it depends on inherent optical properties and the external light source, geometric of light field. So those the parameters like radiance, irradiance and reflectance are apparent optical properties. So based on these things, how we can process the image, these backgrounds, we have to consider these background, the optical optical oceanography background, then we are going to process the satellite images by capturing the signal from the land surface or ocean surface or aquatic, any inland water surface. So the first missions are like in 1978, CSPS is launched by NASA, and then in 1997, CBPS is launched by NASA, and in 1999, India launched with ISRO like Ocean Color Monitor. Is the first Indian satellite which is monitoring for the ocean. So before that we have launched several satellites. First satellite is 1999. So then 2002, Europe has launched MERIS. So these are like those satellites died at some stage, like 2012, 10, 11, 1986, like that. So in 1999 and 2002, MODIS 2, which with different applications like Terra and Aqua, launched by NASA in 1999 and 2002, and still they are in the space. And in 2009, we launched, like India has launched 2000 OCM2 and with the help of ISRO, and in 2011 VIS was launched by NOAA, and 2016 WorldCA is launched by ESA. So yet to come with another two satellites very close in 2021 by OCM3, like Ocean Satellite Ocean Color Monitor 2-3 by ISRO, and 2022 PACE is coming with the help of NASA. So there are a lot of like why we want. We are going to the beach, but different to enjoy by seeing the wave breaking and see the water qualities like that. So, but when so there are some locations like beach like this with a lot of blooms, and so when we are going to go to these locations. So how we can enjoy like their own, we can't see the ocean way, how the water is breaking like that. So these blooms can be monitored by this kind of our ocean color missions, like ocean color or aquatic color missions. So we can do this prevention by how the direction of the transmission. So direction the sediment, the blooms are transmitted from which direction to here, and so we can make the public awareness there are some blooms are coming, so please we can't, so the people are not allowed to go this zones like that. So we can track those blooms movement from through the satellite remote sensing. There will be a lot of models will be there, we can forecast these things like with the help of satellite images. So there are other kind of blooms also there, like Carina brevis from the California coast. These are like land and this is like ocean. So in the ocean you can see this is the thick bloom, red color bloom, and this is another bloom you can see in the off main coast of US, and this is like a Nautilica bloom from European waters, and this is from Bohai Sea. And this is like another tricky bloom, it will glow at the night time. You can see the brightness of the blooms, but these are like very very dangerous blooms, like very toxic. If you eat that fishes in these locations, the people will get a lot of disease like cancer, etc. So how we are collecting data for the validation. So before preparing for the model, we have to go do for the training for processing images. So first we have to do the training. So for that we need a lot of in situ data set. So we got some collaboration with a lot of people from Alaska, from US, and in South America, Europe, and from India, like Chennai and Palima. Of Point Calimar, and Arabian Sea also we have data, but then from Vietnam, Korea, and then New Zealand. So a lot of data we collected based on the collaboration of different people. And so then how we are doing these measurements, like we also used to go for the cruise and we collect the data from the field, and there are two different type of radiometers we were used for the collecting the information. So like different sensors were mounted in the for the measurement of above water radiance, and this is for below water radiance. So this is the Trios optical sensor, which is like highly sensitive to measure the incoming light, the radiance at with the help of the detectors inside the water. It's like in a below water measurement sensors, and they will give the depth and the radiance, irradiance like that. Similarly, so how we are launching the satellite, mounting the sensor in the while doing the measurements, and this is like below water sensor. So this is another type of sensor which is used for measuring the properties of the water, like absorption, scattering, and attenuation, like that. And there are like fluorescence meter also there. So this is the way we would deploy the sensor into the ocean. So these are like with the help of NIOT. So first of all, I forgot to thank NCCR from NIOT campus. So then we are like IIT and NIOT have a good collaboration. We are giving them for collecting the in-situ data set from different coastal waters, different coastal and deep waters. So first of all, thanks to NIOT for providing those facilities. And thanks for NCCR for making good collaboration with the St. Joseph College of Engineering to get this type of processing images for the coastal, developing the coastal environment. Like, so we used to go for cruise and we collect the data set from different coastal and inland waters. And finally, we collect even water sample also. So based on the water sample, we will collect a chlorophyll, suspended sediment, and IOP parameters. So how the spectral shape of the water will be looks like when we are after pressuring, we will go to really, we got data from different waters, like clear water, relatively clear water, relatively turbid water, harbor, and bloom dominated waters. So if you see the clear water, the peak of the primary peak is in the 490 nanometer. So in the when we are plotting the data in the visible spectrum of the electromagnetic region, so we got the peak is line 490 nanometer. Similar to that, the peak is slightly shifting. It's we are going to relatively clear water. The peak is slightly shifting to clear water and to 500 nanometer. So after like a relatively turbid water, you can see the peak is like flattened in from 500 to 550, and from at 550. The peak is the major peak is there in 550 for the turbid waters, and for harbor waters there will be like fluorescence, high fluorescence data at 690, 683 nanometer, and so for bloom dominated water there will be like high scattering values at due to the scattering value at 750 nanometer, and this is for like fluorescence emission. So based on this data set, we will calculate the RRS, like remote sensing reflectance, and which is like a ratio of LW and ED. This one we saw in the previous slide, like in input LW, and in input is ED, like which is going to be below the water, and this is LW, which comes from the water, the light which is leaving from the water. So the ratio of this is gives the reflectance. So just consider this is like a 1 pixel the reflectance value. So if you see the entire pixel, the entire image of the satellite, we will these are the process which happens in the satellite images. So this is another relation is like we have to connect the reflectance, the photometric radiometric values RRS, which is calculated, estimated from the optical sensors, and then we have to connect those values with the inherent optical parameters. So how you are connecting, like there is a ratio of BB by A. So this will change for different quarters, like but this is a simple formula. So this for every absorption and scattering, the parameters will be like changes to decomposes to absorption, particulate absorption, CDOM absorption, and water absorption. So we will consider the ratio of the two different, like the slope of the RRS spectrum is considered as the parameter, considered as the major parameter for estimating the chlorophyll at surface. And this is for the different inland waters, like surface chlorophyll and surface sediments were estimated. And based on that, based on this estimation, we have field data set. This is like a model developed based on the in-situ data set. And we also have another in-situ data set for the validation. So those in-situ data set were used for validation, and the model is validated here, like they are in 1-to-1 with each other, like for sediment and chlorophyll concentration. So from the surface chlorophyll and sediment, we extrapolated the water, chlorophyll values from the surface to bottom of the water column. So this is like below water column, and so how this water last shape of this values. So normally, how with the background of this theory is like there will be like a Gaussian shape of chlorophyll pattern below the water. So why it is no? So when there is a sunlight, when the plants need the sunlight, it comes up, and whenever they don't want sunlight, so it will go down like that. So shifting that, so that euphotic zone will shift from upper layer to the surface to intermediate layer. Sometimes it will go to the bottom also. So like a lake, one of the lake in US, China, then the endear blooms are going to deposit at the bottom. Once the sunlight comes, it comes up like that. So we, based on this, we got some model for the three different values of range of values, and then we modeled this one. This is like for approximately for the relatively clear water, we designed this one. So we estimated the surface chlorophyll, and we applied the model for the Arabian Sea. This is like an Arabian Sea, and the model, that algorithm was applied to the satellite images MODIS Aqua, which captured in 2015. And so the location shows that there are high chlorophyll values, and the major reason for this displaying this image is like you can see the eddies also. We just plotted the chlorophyll values, but the pattern of chlorophyll shows the eddies or currents in which direction it's moving like that, and all we can easily estimate based on this chlorophyll parameter. So likewise, we applied for the global chlorophyll images like all over the world. So we can see here there are like high chlorophyll region, and like here also some high chlorophyll. And so in Gulf of Mannar, in Point Calimar also, we have high chlorophyll data. So how light is transmitted below the water? Like, so when the light reaches the sea surface, we can use the Snell's law for transmission, the transmission of the light, Snell's law and Fresnel reflection function. And based on that, we will get the radiance at below the water. So at each depth, there will be loss of light due to the absorption and scattering of inert optical parameters. So we saw like it's basically like an electromagnetic theory. The attenuation means there is a loss of light or loss of energy or loss of the power for any product. So like that. So here also like we are considering the attenuation as the loss of absorption, loss by absorption and scattering. So we subtracting the radiance with the absorption attenuation parameters, and then there will be some addition of signal due to the particles emits their own light. So there will be like some addition of signal, and this phase function is the angular distribution of the light. So which are the lights coming from different angles, like 180 degree angle we consider here, and those lights are added here. So finally it reaches the bottom and it comes back to the surface. So this background is mainly useful for the underwater image processing. So just if you are going to attend the fifth day presentation, it will be majorly helpful for you. So this is like the entire radiative transurication, which is mainly to simulate the underwater light field parameter. So after developing the underwater light field model, we have applied for the in-situ data over the harbor of Chennai harbor waters. So we got like a black color is the in-situ measured one, and the orange color is the modeled one. So modeled one is like almost like matching with the in-situ data set, and there are some small portions like error, but it's almost better than the other regions. And so like a blue color is the predicted one. We considered all the atmospheric correction parameters, and then we predicted this blue color, but there may be some overestimation in the prediction light. Maybe we didn't consider the proper atmospheric correction algorithm. So this underwater light field visibility is mainly used for Navy application and coral reef and sea grass mapping through remote sensing, and the heat budget and underwater communication also we can use. So there are two portions we are considered here. Like one is homogeneous, like a diffuse dam, and another one is a direct dam. So what is diffuse dam, like a homogeneous layer? So it is like this can be useful for very, very clear water. So if you consider the very clear water, we don't want to consider the just the light from different depths, different angles are should be considered here for the estimation of light at each depth. But in the inhomogeneous layer, at each depth the layer of the concentration layer is different, so we have to consider the water light from adjacent depth or adjacent layer, which is you consider for the radiative transfer model. So each depth we have to consider this one, the light from the adjacent depth is considered as the input, and estimate the radiance like that we have to consider for entire depth. So then now we can go to the missions for aquatic color remote sensing. So you can see the 2018 May image and 2019 June image. So this is like captured by Landsat image. There are like aquatic different, like ocean instrument are like different, and aquatic instruments are different for satellite sensors. So what are the we will see some satellites for which are monitoring the aquatic system, like in the inland water and land, also land remote sensing and land coastal, everything we can see here with these satellites. So this image shows what is the importance of how much important this satellite is necessary for us for monitoring agriculture or inland water body or transportation like that. So what are the satellites available for the inland water body? So like in 1972 there is a Landsat sensor launched by NASA in 1972, and it reaches 1978, and 75 have Landsat 2 and Landsat 3 is there. So Landsat 4, these are like not much data were not much used, because the technology is like you can think that technology around those years are how much useful for processing images. So but they are currently those data can be used, but not much used for the compared with the recent satellite, those are like less resolution images. So in Landsat 4, we used the Landsat 4 is launched in 1982, and until 1983 it is there, and Landsat 5 in 1984 to 2013. So then Landsat 6 got failed, and Landsat 7 is another failure. Like in 1999 it's launched, and after that in 2003 the one of the mirror in that Landsat 7 satellite got failed. So the images got flipped there. So even though we can use that image, but the images got some types of noise in the Landsat 7 image. So then, and in 90 Landsat 8 was launched in 2013, and we are using that now. So in 2021 we are waiting for the Landsat 9 also. So similar to like European Space Agency also launched Sentinel 2A and 2B in 2015 and 2017. So currently we have three satellites, like to Landsat 8, Sentinel 2A, and Sentinel 2B. These satellites will come to. So this satellite will come every 7 days once above our institute. If you see, if you are standing in front of St. Joseph College of Engineering, This satellite will come every 7 days once. This will come every 5 days once. So this will come every 5 days once. So we have to utilize this sensor for so combine the sensor and combine the the check the consistency of each sensor images and make them as the single image, like a single satellite image, and we can monitor based on what are the changes are happening near to the inland location, or what are the changes has done for the previous day or previous week or previous month. Based on these images we can check. So another two satellites are coming, in Landsat 9 is coming in 2021 and 22C is coming. So if we have five satellites, then we will get images, like daily images we can get. So we can check the parking of vehicle also, we can check based on once these two satellites are launched. So and another, this Landsat 9 is majorly used for the agriculture purpose. We can utilize that one for crop agriculture, how much the vegetation has done and how much profit has gotten, like that. So how we want to combine, we have satellite images from 1984 to 2020, like, so how we are combining. So they are like different technologies. So in 84 images launched in with a different technology, and 2013, 2015, 2017 satellites are launched with the different technologies. So but we want the consistency of the data set. We want to take all the entire data set, so we can map what are the changes last 20-30 years has happened using those images. So we want to calibrate Landsat Sentinel 2A-2B and Landsat 5-7-8. So we can match that one. So we calibrated the data using the Hawaii Island data, it's a clear water data, and Mediterranean Sea and Western Australia. So atmospheric correction, we removed all the atmospheric correction parameters. So satellite is in the top of the atmosphere. We removed all the atmospheric correction or atmospheric layer in the model and the radiative transfer model. And then we just kept the sensor, made the satellite is sitting just above the water, so we can calibrate the satellite data. After the calibration, we validated with the Aeronaut data set. Aeronaut is like a good network, radiometric, which gives the radiometric data all over the world. So there are a lot of instruments mounted in the coastal area and which gives good radiometric data set. And the shipborne data also we used for the validation. So we applied the gain values for the different coastal and inland waters, and so we made the consistency with each other. So this is the image we got from Busol. So this data, the data from this location is used for the calibration. So these are like very clear water. So we don't want any noise, right? And when we are doing the calibration, we don't want any noise in the satellite images. So we consider this type of data. After calibration, we can see how much sediments or how much noise are there in the images for the realistic location. So before calibration, we got the data like negative values and in the different bands. But so after doing the calibration, we got some gain value, and with the gain value, we can see that the values are like 1-to-1 with each other. So this is like a validation data set, and this is the data from the images. So the processed satellite images are here. You can see different bands, 4, 4, 9, 43 blue and coastal and blue bands are here. So we also checked the data received from different bands, different satellites, Landsat 7 and MODIS Terra. So how we are checking, right? So we want to make all the images like a single satellite image. We want to see the database, everyday database. So for that purpose, we just validated the data with the MODIS Terra, and you can see the values are matching. After the calibration only, we did this one, we validated. So the values are almost matching with each other, similar kind of validation as done for Landsat 5 and MODIS Aqua. So they are almost matching with each other. So now you can see Landsat 5 is launched in 1984, and this is 1999, and this is 2013. So we want we are just showing the maximum we tried the calibration and the noise removal after the atmospheric correction. So we showed the data from three images are almost close to each other. You can monitor like with like if there is some small changes also, you can monitor how much changes like there in the San Francisco Bay. This is the northern San Francisco Bay. So these are like three different bands, and so three different images from three different years from three different satellites. So this can be shown. Why? So we got this analysis. Based on this analysis, we come to know that we can match the images from three different satellites. Like, so this is like a sand, small Apopka Lake, which is in the Florida, and so this Florida image. So this is like a highly green water. You can see in the RJ normal image itself, it's like a highly green water. So we processed the sediment, like sediment for the sediment for these waters and this small lake, and we the images here, like these are like satellite images from the Landsat. So now we saw Landsat and Sentinel. So how the Landsat and Sentinel are matching like that. So we tested that same day. So same day, both satellites are coming to each other. So this is like Sentinel and this is like Landsat OLI. So both are coming on same day, but there is some small differences there. But so again, we tested in different another day, but this day the image is like both images are all giving same type of data. So similar kind of analysis has done another 2-3 days. So same day, these stars are showing that the satellites are coming meeting same day with the 2 hours difference. Okay. So other images shows different days. Other points are shows different days. Similar kind of analysis has done for like San Francisco Bay in the West Coast, and so there also we did we got only two days where the both satellites meet each other on the same location. So 2 days images are almost same, giving same data. So means like the star is sitting in the blank star. So these are like sediment parameters, like the sediment, how much sediments are suspended in the water surface. So how we model the sediment, suspended sediment. So we classified, we saw different types of spectrum for clear, turbid, and bloom water, like so different kind of electromagnetic spectrum or reflectance spectrum in the electromagnetic region. We classified those data with a different based on these conditions and the type 1, type 2, and type 3 waters, like blue, green, and green, and brown waters, like that. So this is like highly bloom water. So you can see this type of waters in the lake, and this is like brown waters. You can see this kind of water in the river. And this is like coastal waters, like type 1. Not coastal waters, it's like a little deep water. So we used the machine learning techniques. We are sending the RRS spectrum, but we landed we have only four bands. So these four bands are given as input to the neural network. So we trained this data set and to obtain the BPP values. BPP is an intermediate parameters like IOP parameters, inherent optical properties. So which is like scattering. The BPP is the back scattering values, which can be used for the retrieval of sediments. So we used here two different parameters like mean and the standard deviation of the RRS values to receive the this BPP. So after the validation, so we got some good results. So like these are like standard models. Our model also almost sitting with those two values in between the so like good shows good results. So we are testing the model. So we already like we trained the model. So now we want to test the model whether it's working good or not, like that. So we tested model with different algorithms. So like this algorithm shows that data is just worse underestimated and all the three. So this is the one of the standard model used after 2010, but it's so after testing with this data set, we got that the model is failed at some range. So this is after 2012, the people used this model. Like this is like doing good, but still the values are like overestimated. So similarly, like our model shows like doing good, shows good results from clear water. This is like a bloom water, and this is like a sediment dominated water. So we tested the algorithm, our algorithm for the Chesapeake Bay in the east coast of the US. And so this is the Chesapeake Bay. We used this north part of the Chesapeake Bay for analysis. So we applied the standard model to the satellite image, Landsat image for different days. And so these days shows that, almost like we saw in the scatter plot, previous scatter plot. So how the values are like underestimated, right? So same type of same underestimated. So here a lot of rivers and here some, the incoming water will be pushing some sediments. So here these areas are highly dominated with the sediments. But this model shows that the sediment is not available in this location like that. So, but next one is like 2012 model. 12 model shows the sediments are there, but we already saw the scatter plot shows that the model is overestimated. Like it shows high values than the observed one. So this is our model. Our model shows different pattern of like sediment movement, and so the values are almost like the validation results also shows that it's almost like 1-to-1. So matching with the observed data set. So the, our models is doing good with the satellite images. So we just published this paper like in March of 2020. And so the model is playing a major role in different inland waters over the US area. So we are processing a lot of images from Landsat and Sentinel by applying this data set. And this data set can, those images are, we are going to utilize the things in the USGS website. So we, if you're familiar with the USGS website, you come to know that sediment, there is a sediment column. So our model is going to utilized by those people for the displaying the sediment images. So currently we started a small startup company. So we are working with the different machine learning techniques for automatic object detection. For the industrial applications and artificial intelligence based machines also we are working on. So satellite products, simultaneously we are working with NASA for providing the satellite products through the image processing. And also we are working on the land remote sensing, like land use, land cover, and other parameters involved in the water resource parameters for the inland waters. So also we are working for applications. So like forecasting application development for forecasting the weather and forecasting the images like rainfall, those type of data sets also we are forecasting for iOS and Android platform. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for sitting sitting with me and seeing the slides, and hope this slides presentation is useful for you people. Thank you so much. And so you can contact me anytime. If there is any questions, you can contact me, or if you have any doubts or queries, you can send me an email. So thank you so much. If you have questions, you're welcome.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for your remarkable session, sir. It really helped us to understand the various perspectives of ocean study, the satellite calibration, validation, training, and testing models, and all the machine learning stuff. Even you gave us the upcoming industrial working projects, sir, review on that. All these are very much useful for everyone here, sir. Shall we move on to the Q&A session, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Yes. Suresh sir will be joining us, sir. He'll be reading out the questions for you, and you can answer one by one, sir.
Hi,
Thank you, Sundara Balan sir. I'll ask the question. Question from Devi Ganapathi. Is there any relationship between chlorophyll concentration, depth and fish potential zones from the model studies?
Yes. So there are relations between chlorophyll and potential fishing zone. So normally we know that where there is the food, there will be the there will be. So the fishes are going to. So the major food resource for the fishes are like chlorophyll only. Major resources. So where there is a fish, chlorophyll, we will get more fishes. So that is the major concept. But so based on this concept, we can understand the fishing zone. If there is a high chlorophyll area, those area we can estimate that that is a potential fishing zone for the catching fishes. Like,
okay.
So
thank you,
yeah.
sir. And one more question from Usha Rani. How do we model parameters using ML, machine learning? How do we model parameters using machine learning? Any method is available?
Yeah, there are a lot of machine learning techniques like supervised, unsupervised, like linear regression, logistic regression, like CNN. So we used CNN method to estimate those parameters, like we trained the model. So there are like we used the training data set for making the used the training data set for to develop the model. We almost like used hydrolite simulation, like hydrolite simulated data set. It's a like standard additive tensor model, and that model is used for simulating the training data set. So currently we have, if you see that paper, we have the model for machine learning technique. That model is already, the link is available in the website. You can see, if you go through that paper, and that paper shows that the model link, it will take directly to the model. So we published the model in the website also. You can download the code based on our CNN.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. And one more question. From Aarti Sitapathi, sir, is it possible to apply normalized difference vegetation index for ocean images?
Yeah, but it's not that much possible because the vegetation is not much in the ocean. Because the spectrum, the NIR spectrum is mainly used for atmospheric correction. So we can't use that NIR spectrum for vegetation retrieval in the ocean. In the land, that is not that is possible, but in the ocean, we can use only green and green and blue band for the retrieval of chlorophyll.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Okay. And one question from Devi Ganapathi, ma'am. Which Landsat bands or channels are selected for SS studies? Landsat, we have seven bands, no, sir?
Yeah, correct, yeah. Mm-hmm. So seven bands for visible, for aquatic systems, okay. So red band is used for sediment retrieval. But so if you are using the atmospheric correction in the sphere band, short wave infrared band, then you can use like NIR band for the retrieval of sediments. So we have like, for example, we have 616, 665 and 869 bands are there. So if there is a high sediment, we can use 869 for the sediment retrieval. So the 869 can be used for high sediment retrieval. If it is low sediment, then 665 can be used. Okay.
Thank you, sir. And a question from Asha Pandian, ma'am. Can you suggest some books related to machine learning and remote sensing, sir?
Machine learning, remote sensing. There is no, not that, because machine learning is the new domain, but There is no books in machine learning right now. I think even computer science people also waiting for writing the new books. But there are some online books. We have some papers now. We have like three different papers for machine learning. We implemented the model with machine learning. So if you go through those papers, like if you go through my Google Scholar, and you can find that papers, then you can, if you read those paper, that is enough for understanding the machine learning with the remote sensing application. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. And we have more online materials also, no, sir?
Yeah, online material also there, but they are not in terms of remote sensing. So they are like industrial remote image processing or application for satellite image, other image processing, it's there. But satellite remote sensing, the machine learning is just started, like by like 3 years before only the machine learning was implemented for satellite images. So it's a new domain. If you add machine learning and remote sensing, you will be like a unique person.
Okay. Okay, sir. Yeah. And one more question from Devi Ganapathi, ma'am. Airborne lidar sensors are not used for coastal and land dynamics studies. Why, sir?
So the airborne lidar, I'm not sure, because I'm not working much in airborne lidar, but I started working. So hopefully the airborne is like, it's like difficult to collect the data, right? So every day we can't fly over the coastal zone or inland zone. Every day that's airborne, we have to take the aircraft and fly over the area to collect the data. So we can't find the changes for over the coastal zone using the, it's very cost to run the aircraft over the location. So that may be the reason for not using the airborne lidar.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. And another question from Usha Rani, ma'am. May I know which band of wavelength is used for the study of sea?
So we have like four 443 is the one of the band for Landsat, and another one 489, and another one 555, and then 665 and 869. And some more bands in the shortwave infrared, like 1269 and 1136, like that. So totally six bands are there.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
We can use that one. If you have more bands, we will get more details from this ocean. So currently these things are there. So entire visible region of the electromagnetic spectrum, we can use for the designing the sensor. But if you have more sensor, the clarity or the quality, time of the satellite movement, and those things will be difficult to get. So that is the reason people reduce the band information and provide the good image. Right?
Okay, thank you, sir. And last question is from Dr. Naveen Kumar. Can you suggest some current open research work?
Open research work in this domain. Yeah, in this domain, we have underwater image processing, underwater communication, and parallelly like the sea coral reef monitoring, coral reef monitoring, sediment transport over the coastal area. These are the current research going in this field.
Sir, one more question from Girija Madam.
Yeah.
Is CNN fine-grained or a hybrid or predefined? Convolutional neural network model.
Yeah. So I used CNN hybrid model.
Okay, sir. Okay. Sir. Could you please tell any app is developed in remote sensing applications?
So we are working in that, and I don't know the competitors who are working with us like right now. Even weather forecasting images. So daily you are seeing the weather images, right? So those images also like from remote sensing only. How much weather today? So how much rainfall? Weather rainfall. we will receive rainfall or not, like that. So those are like examples of remote sensing app. But we are working for ocean, so like for potential fishing zone identification only we are working. So hopefully we'll launch those app in 6 to 7 months, like that.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. And one question from my side, sir. Is hyperspectral images used for this ocean applications? Because I used Landsat images, low resolution images for for estimating the water spread area and all. And also used hyperspectral images also. And for ocean applications, is it possible to use this hyperspectral images? And whether it gives more accurate results than low resolution images?
Correct. So good question. This is like, so you have only, so Landsat have only 4 bands, right? With the 4 bands, I am collecting the information of ocean. In the coastal zone. So if you have 100 bands, like, so your hyperspectral sensor have 100 bands, so you'll get more information than Landsat. But how much time it will take to capture the image? So how much each detector to detect the each detector for each bands, you need a detector. So to capture the one image itself, it will take like 5 minutes, 10 minutes, like that. So we want to move the satellite within a minute. The satellite should move from this location to another location. So then how it's difficult to get the satellite to capture the image. That is the reason we are using multispectral. We are not using hyperspectral. So if you are able to use the hyperspectral, then it is more advantage.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. And one more question from all participants. Where we will get these satellite images? If you give some input to them, they'll be very happy.
So you can use that usgs.com. USGS, United States Geological Survey. Okay, so USGS website, I can type, okay. So you can check in the USGS. If you type USGS, it will come. It's like a big organization in the US. So there are a lot of images are there, satellite images. Sir. So, and for India also, we have like NRC, National Remote Sensing Center. They are also providing Indian satellite data set. So you can collect from those people, those websites.
So from USGS, we'll get free images, sir?
Yeah, free images.
Free images, sir. Sir, is it possible to get images for the consecutive days?
Yeah, that's what I told you. So for every day, every 7 days once only, the Landsat is visiting our area. So 7 days once, we will get our image. And next, after 7 days, Sentinel is coming every 3 days once. So currently we can get only 3 days once image. Maybe after 1 year, we have another 2 satellites going to launch by US and European Space Agency. After that, we will get every day image. So every day there will be a satellite. So we can receive image from satellites for every day for an okay location. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Sir, while downloading images, there are some images are full of cloud coverage and all. Is it possible to extract the cloud coverage, and after that we can? Is it possible to process the image? Is there any methodology available?
Yeah.
Just my question.
Yeah, there are like different atmospheric correction algorithms are available. So we are to publish a paper in one or two months. Like we already those papers in interview. So there are different algorithms are there to remove the atmospheric layer. But if it is a thick cloud, we can't remove that one.
And one question from Saravana Kumar, sir. How do we analyze radiography image processing of any disease? Is it related to?
Is it not much related to this presentation?
Okay, tomorrow, yeah. Saravana Kumar sir, tomorrow we'll answer your question. Tomorrow the session is on medical image processing. So most probably you'll get the answer. And thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Divya?
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for answering us very patiently. So I think Suresh Kumar sir has not joined us today due to some unavoidable emergency. So you have covered the session very well on behalf of him as well, sir. Thank you so much, sir. May I request Helton ma'am to deliver the vote of thanks. Helton ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir, for spending your valuable time with us in your busy schedule. It is rightly said as it is not a session, but the people that make the session worth remembering. Yes, first of all, I would like to propose our hearty welcome to today's speaker, Dr. V.B. Sundarabalan, for this gracing session. We express our gratitude for accepting our request to provide an interesting and thought-provoking address in his busy schedule. Thanks for making this session a more rememberable one. And I would like to express our profound gratitude to our management for the constant support. I'd like to thank our beloved HOD, Mrs. Lata Salvi ma'am, for her moral support, encouragement, and guidance. Finally, a special thanks for the wonderful participants who have turned up in such a great number, not only from our department, but from our college, but from other colleges and universities throughout India. Thank you so much for your cooperation. Thank you. Divya?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. I thank all the participants for showing interest in this FDP on applications of image processing. Hope everyone is much benefited throughout this day's session. Yes. Please fill the feedback and attendance form posted in the chat box of YouTube. Let us meet again tomorrow, the same time, 10:30, for having another session on image processing, and the topic will be medical image processing by Dr. Imba Malarma. Have a good day. Bye.
So we will wait for some time for the participants to fill the feedback and attendance. Yes, Divya?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. We'll wait.